Hey guys, it's Flower Gothic, and I guess I'm a musical review channel now. Why? Well, for some fucking reason, I'm doing another video on a musical. Why me? I don't even like musicals that much. Fuck my life. But I must put my ambivalence aside, as we are here to talk about Hazbin Hotel. The internet lately, you've probably seen something Hazbin Hotel related. It could be fan art, fan fiction, or incredibly unhinged Demon Rule 34. It could even be that 50k commission by the guy who did Tetris Beatbox. You know, the one where he gets gooned by the show's protagonist? Yeah, that. It's like the Forrest Gump of fandom culture. Wherever you go, it finds you. And I'm not even exaggerating, like, I'm filming this in April and I've been to 2 fan conventions this month. And at both of them, I have seen at least a handful of people cosplaying as Hazbin Hotel characters. But for those mercifully unaware, Hazbin Hotel is a black comedy horror drama that premiered in January of 2024. It's set in a world where hell itself is a dystopian nightmare with an overpopulation problem. Most of the people there are creatures known as sinners, or humans that died and went to hell. The show centers around Charlie Morningstar, the princess of hell. She wants to rehabilitate these sinners by running the Hazbin Hotel. It follows her attempts to make her hotel work, despite most sinners not really wanting to be redeemed. Oh, and she also needs to find out what to do about Heaven's annual purge of demons. Yeah, a bunch of angels purge demons every year. That's how they solve the overpopulation problem. Sweet! Among the hotel denizens are Vaggy, Charlie's girlfriend, Alistair, a mysterious, powerful sinner who's Charlie's benefactor, albeit for his own amusement, and Angel Dust, another sinner and gay porn star Charlie's trying to redeem. It started life as a YouTube pilot by Salvadoran American animator Vivian Medrano. Medrano was already a bit of a name on the internet for her webcomic Zoophobia, which I know very little about. All you need to know is it included characters later refurbished for, well, Hazbin Hotel. The pilot was an instant viral success when it dropped in 2019. How much of a success was it? Well, less than a year after its premiere, A24, yes, that A24, picked it up for a full-fledged season on Amazon Prime. Then again, A24 has been posting some cringe lately, so it's not as surprising as I once thought it was. The series got rave reviews from critics, but the general audience is polarized, to say the least. You have super fans who adore the series, and anti-fans who think its very premise is problematic. You have those who think that it's an iconic queer show, and those who think it falls back on LGBT stereotypes. Let's look at some reviews from everyone's favorite cesspool of amateur critics, Rotten Tomatoes!
Great songs and great voice cast, good writing and amazing characters.
If you're young or stunted enough, the word vagina gets a big laugh out of you with no other context, then you'll probably love this. Everyone else, forget it.
An eye-catching, bombastic tale of the Princess of Hell with a heart of gold, trying to save her people. It's, to me, as if Jonan Vasquez had devised a show around Supernatural and set it to Frozen. I love it.
Makes Family Guy look classy and smart by comparison, so I guess there's that.
While its pacing can be a bit off at times, leading to very rushed character moments, it's a very fun and entertaining show with absolute bangers for songs, a great cast, and fun characters. Yeah, they curse a lot and have a lot of sexual jokes and references, but the series literally takes place in hell, so I think they get a pass.
Anyone who tries to excuse the show's long list of flaws with "they're literally in hell" owes me $5.
God, all these low rating reviews are trash. If you want to watch something that's actually original in this day and age, then look no further than Hazbin Hotel.
It gets you thinking. It's not the breakneck pace or the shoddy world building or even the constant potholes that break the series for me. It's a chilling lack of empathy.
Well, if you like riding the roller coaster that is emotions and feelings, Hazbin Hotel is full of that. It certainly has its pacing issues, but I think that's the fault of the current expectations from big corporate media wanting shows to be shorter and
How can we be expected to care about these characters if they don't really care about each other?
I could sing praises for Hazbin Hotel all day if I could.
How can we be expected to buy what they're selling when they talk about redemption and self-improvement and found family?
A seriously enjoyable show, if only they'd fix the pacing, characters, voices, writing, music, plot, and creator.
So, yeah, very polarizing. But I think the true value of Hazbin lies somewhere in the middle. Yes, most of the characters are awful people. Yes, the lore is garbage. Yes, the animation could be better, but this show can still be redeemed. It has good parts, and it hurts to watch such a hyped up show be painfully, painfully mediocre. So today, I want to talk about that painful mediocrity. I want to talk about the problems with Hazbin Hotel, the parts I liked, and what I think needs to be done to make season 2 good, or at the very least, better. But first! For those of you new here, I tend to have a set of rules and disclaimers before the meat of my videos. This time, I have two disclaimers, one regarding Medrano and one regarding her other work in the Hazbin Hotel universe. First, I will not be discussing any of Medrano's controversies. I am aware of the allegations of her underpaying people, her racism, her transphobia, and so on. I am not a drama channel, and I just don't know enough about the allegations to make a fair judgment. I want to judge Hazbin on its own merits, rather than taint them with Medrano's alleged problematic behavior. Second, I will not be talking about Hazbin Hotel's sister series, Hell of a Boss. Hell of a Boss has its own plot, characters, world building, and flaws that don't really tie in with Hazbin's. Yes, I know it's mostly because of rights issues, but still. If you want to learn more about Hell of a's problems, I recommend this video by friend of the channel, Madeline May. Okay, here are the rules for today's video. One, this is, by all accounts, an opinion piece. This is my opinion about a show. It might not align with your opinion about the show. You don't have to agree with me. Two, but any comments attacking me or others will be deleted and reported. Please behave yourselves. Three, as always, do not harass anyone I mention in this video. Don't dogpile, don't call out, just don't harass anyone, please. I'm begging you. And now, on with the show. Okay, I need to get this out of the way first. The animation is not the best. The character design is a mixed bag. On one hand, each demon looks unique, and it's clear Medrano has a style that's gracefully copied onto here. But I have big issues with some of that style. We'll get to that in a second. But first, the characters aren't the only problem with the animation. For one thing, behind these colorful characters is, well, a lack of color. The backgrounds and the characters have similar palettes. It's to the point where characters look drawn in the scene rather than a part of it. I didn't realize how bad it was, though, until I saw this Twitter thread from They took a shot and compared its values by grayscaling and blurring it. It showed there was so little contrast between the characters in the background that everything looked flat. During my watch through, I noticed a lot of this lack of contrast, but until I saw this thread, I couldn't quite put my finger on why I was thinking that. So I went through my notes and found some scenes where I complained about the lack of contrast. I then did the same effects as on Photoshop. Here are my results. See how some of the color values are similar? Do you see how some of the characters blend into the background? Now, you might be thinking, so what? So, I did the same test on some episodes of one of Medrano's favorite shows, Family Guy. And that show had better results. You can tell the color ranges vary between characters and background. You can still make them out! Also, the animation needed more in-betweeners. What is an in-betweener? They're the people who animate the frames between key storyboard ones. If you've ever wondered why animatics are not really animated, it's because they don't have in-betweeners. They only have the key storyboard bits. Here, I'll show you. In Aspen's case, the lack of in-betweeners makes some of the animation janky. Like, it's clear they missed some frames between the key storyboard parts, and some frames are just missing? Here are the ones that were especially noticeable to me.
What could they want this soon after—
I can do this. Somehow I know it. I'll get heaven behind my plan.
I fucking made him! Without me, he's just a bag of meat with some mildly entertaining holes.
Angel, quit. Meeting me poison, addicted to this feeling,
I can't help but swallow up your poison. Alistair, pleasure to be meeting you, sir. Quite a pleasure.
Stuck with the fear of losing that somebody who's your reason to live.
Like, I got motion sickness at some points, and I couldn't look away. I had to watch for this video.
Even if the animation was perfect, I would still have my qualms about this show. Namely, most of the characters aren't good, to say the least. They're people I don't sympathize with, stock characters, not developed enough for me to care, or some mod podge of those three.
Let's go back to that character design. Most of the characters are thin and white. Of course, there are exceptions, but they're few, far between, and problematic. There's Mimsy, who only appears in one episode as the butt of some jokes. There are the V's, who are secondary characters at best. There's the Snake, who again is the butt of some jokes. And there's the Cat, who is voiced by a black actor, and whose soul is owned by the white Alistair. That's not good, to say the least.
But Flower, you say? They're demons. Demons don't have race.
Okay, sure, but what about when they were alive? Most of the major characters are white-coated. I know the wiki says Alistair is a mixed race Creole, but here's the thing. I'm Cajun. I am ethnically Cajun. I was born in Louisiana, and I currently live in Louisiana. I'm gonna go ahead and nip that bullshit in the bud.
Medrano mentions that Alistair was a famous radio host who moonlighted as a serial killer. But here's the thing. Louisiana was notoriously racist during Alistair's lifespan, more so than it is now. Despite being a majority black city, New Orleans was no exception to this. In fact, New Orleans was ground zero for a major Supreme Court case that racialized the Jim Crow laws. Who was the man who brought this to the courts? Mixed Creole man Homer Plessy. Yes, the Plessy and Plessy v. Ferguson! During the Jim Crow era, black and mixed-race Americans were treated horribly. Hell, Louisiana was one of the first states to take advantage of the Plessy v. Ferguson ruling. They effectively disenfranchised minorities for decades, and we're still suffering from the fallout of that to this day!
And trust me, Alistair wouldn't have been able to be a radio star slash serial killer in Louisiana in the 1930s.
By the way, the first black full-time radio personality in the South wasn't hired until 1949. His name was Vernon Daddio Winslow, and one New Orleans TV station did a really good piece on him. I recommend it. It's in the bibliography for this video if you want to read or watch it.
One final thing. He was voiced by the very white Edward Bosco in the pilot, which was the only time Alastor referenced his heritage.
Well, I'm starved. Who wants some jambalaya? My mother once showed me a wonderful recipe for jambalaya. In fact, it nearly killed her.
That jambalaya better not have tomatoes in it. Now, you might also be asking, but what about Vaggy? What about Carmilla? What about Valentino? They're Hispanic coded.
Yes. Vaggy was heavily implied, if not outright confirmed, to be Salvadoran. But that was in the pilot only. And her new background makes it very unclear if she ever had a human life, so her bilingualism just comes off as odd sometimes. Secondly, we don't know if Carmilla is a sinner or a hellborn. Yes, she's an overlord, but she has two daughters! It's never made clear if they're biological or adopted! If they're biological, that means Carmilla is a hellborn, as sinners can't procreate. That's one of the rules of this world. The one exception is if they were Carmilla's daughters when she was alive, but again, that's never made clear. It's also never made clear if hellborn demons can be overlords too, because if they can, that completely changes how the fucking hierarchy works. And in regards to Valentino, you realize he's a pimp, right? That kinda folds back into the cat being owned by Alistair thing I mentioned earlier.
For the record, I do know the snake and the cat have names, but I don't remember them. I also think it's funnier just to keep calling them that.
Now, we can look over the characters themselves. We'll start with the hotel owner herself, Charlie Morningstar. To me, she's not really an original character. She's the amalgamation of every manic pixie dream girl you can think of. She's this upbeat, positive young woman. She wants to use her hotel to redeem her subjects. And she's so darn positive, she just can't see why her plan falls flat on its feet.
And like, that's her only goal for the season. She wants to redeem the sinners, staying in her hotel without any personal gain on her end.
She reminds me a lot of Holly Golightly in Breakfast at Tiffany's and Sam in Garden State, but both of those characters aren't people with their own goals or desires. Holly is a free-spirited young woman. She's the quirky foil to depressed writer Paul Varjak. Her only character development comes when Paul tells her to fuck off and grow up. Sam is a quirky, free-spirited woman. She comes into struggling actor Andrew Largeman's life after his mom died. Both female characters bring wonder and whimsy back in the lives of their male heroes. Charlie tries to bring a desire to live and redeem oneself to her guests at the Hasbin Hotel. That's all she wants to do. She wants to manic pixie dream girl herself into the lives of other people without thinking of the consequences.
Vaggy was one of the few characters I actually liked. She's a good foil to Charlie, and she's someone who I actually want to see succeed because she's, you know, realistic.
But for most of the show, I didn't see any romance between her and Charlie, and for a while I was kind of confused by the nature of their relationship. They seemed more like business partners than a couple. Vaggy seemed like Charlie's exhausted assistant, tired of her antics. Also, Vaggy's cursing never felt forced. In fact, it really fit with her character.
I'm sorry, what the fuck was that?
Pentius was just trying to take over the city with his weird steampunk bullshit a few days ago.
Okay, enough of that. Angel, what the fuck?
The thing with the thing, fuck, God.
There's another thing I like about her, but we cannot talk about that. Well, unless we get through the rest of the series, which we are going to do right now.
Ari went over the issues pertaining to Alistair's race, but let's take a moment to talk about the character himself. He was entertaining to watch, for sure. His quips, bits, and lack of cursing made him a very pleasant bystander to the chaos happening around him. But I don't quite know what his relationship with Charlie is like. It starts with Alistair benefiting her for his own amusement, but over time, and seemingly for no reason, he starts to actually help Charlie? He introduced Charlie to a fellow overlord to help her recruit troops for La Resistance. But he also kept a massive secret on how to stop the extermination to himself. He only revealed it when Charlie was emotionally vulnerable enough to make a deal, aka sell her soul, to him. He staffed the hotel, sure, but he also keeps his true intentions far from Bay. And I get Alistair's supposed to be a neutral character, but this isn't neutral. This is confusing. Let's say Alistair truly is doing this for his own amusement. Why is he bothering to help Charlie at all? Like, aside from giving her some staff and protecting the hotel from outside threats.
But Flower, you say, isn't Alistair's confusing behavior supposed to be the point?
There's a difference between a neutral character and a character with confusing morals.
Neutral characters tend to do what they want on their own terms. Catwoman, for example, she's not with the good guys or the bad guys. She sides with whatever's most convenient for her at the time. Craig Bond is another example. He does whatever he wants or needs to do, mostly for his own convenience or to help the people he cares about. With Alistair, we don't know why he's doing what he's doing. There isn't a clear or consistent motive for almost anything he does. Is he helping Charlie fight the extermination for the lulz? To save his own hide? To actually help her? Who knows?
Angel Dust is one of the major characters I disliked.
In the pilot, he was fine, I guess? He seemed more like a lovable rascal. Now, he's just an annoying freeloader who wants the sexies and the drugs. And he frequently sexually harasses the other characters. And that's played for laughs.
But Flower, they're supposed to be terrible people, you say.
Well, Angel's supposed to be sympathized with. He's supposed to be one of the good guys.
You can't have it both ways. You can't play harassment and assault for laughs one day and then play it seriously the next.
The snake and the cat are okay. They're the only main characters who don't look like stick figures, and I appreciate that. Also, the cat is voiced by Keith David, so that's a win. And finally, we have our main villain of the season, Adam. Yes, that Adam. It's very subtle though, try to guess it.
This virtue chick was digging on the drummer, and it's like, do you know who I am? I'm fucking Adam. I'm the original dick. Yeah, sure got me here, didn't it? Right, Sarah? I'm fucking Adam! I'm the fucking man, and you're just some fucking clown or something! I started everything on Earth! All of mankind came from these fucking nuts!
Adam is basically the Cartman of the show. He's politically incorrect. He's sexist. He's homophobic, except for girl on girl, because that's hot. He lives in sin, despite, you know, being an angel! And I think that was supposed to be the appeal? Like, hey, look, the original man turned out to be a douche! Clap for us! But Adam's existence is more annoying than anything. He's just mean, and there's nothing about him that makes him enjoyable. With Cartman, at least you got shenanigans from him! So he's overshadowed by the other villainous characters.
This actually brings up another problem with the characters. There are way too many! The overlords are a good example of this. They have distinctive personalities and motives, but aside from Carmilla and Valentino and Alistair, they play little role in the main plot.
Valentino's introduction was played for laughs. He was being a crybaby because Angel Dust moved into the Has-Been Hotel. But at that point, I already knew about the infamous assault scene in episode 4. That made Valentino completely unfunny to me. Again, you can't have it both ways! With Carmilla, her introduction in episode 3 confused me more than anything. That was mostly because she had two duets. Let me make it clear. Daphne Lubin Vega is a great actress and singer, but she did not need two duets in her introductory episode when we didn't even know that much about her. It felt like they wanted to take advantage of having Lubin Vega in the cast, and that was at the cost of making Carmilla a relevant character. Her distant duet with Vaggy, where she talks about her daughters, who are her daughters? Does that mean she's actually a Hellborn? We went over this, so I won't raise any more questions right now. Velvet's only significant role was revealing the severed head head of an angel Carmilla killed. And all that does is show, yes, angels can be killed! Thanks for playing! Vox's only significant role is to complain about Alistair for reasons unknown.
But he got the snake to go to the hotel.
Valentino could have easily done that instead! Rosie's only significant role was to tell Charlie to not break up with Maggie. Oh, and to help her rally up troops for that extermination resistance. Alistair could have helped Charlie with both on his own. Rosie only speaks in that episode. Jesus Christ! Sestril's only role is to be scary.
And again, those are all overlords. Which brings us to...
The world building in Hazbin Hotel is a mess, to say the least. Did you see how I just named every single overlord who appeared in the series so far?
You forgot Zizi.
Every single overlord who spoke in the series so far. I can tell who's who and what they're, well, overlording. But what I don't know is how the hotel came to be. We know who is in there and why it exists, but when did Charlie come up with her brilliant plan? How did she talk angel dust into crashing at the hotel? I know there's a prequel comic that explains that last question, but what are the chances people who only know about the show know about it?
Madeline May and I actually talked about this. We agreed that the show spends too much time building up its lore and setting without giving us an actual plot.
Let's go back to the three V-named overlords, Vox, Valentino, and Velvet. Their introduction is amazing. It's much better than how the characters were introduced in the pilot. In the pilot, we knew about way too many characters in way too little time. We didn't need an intro to Cherry Bomb. She doesn't even appear until episode 6. With the Vs, we're immediately privy to their personalities, wants, and relationships. We can tell Vox is the savvy yet sleazy executive who has a grudge against Alistair. We can tell Valentino is an abusive fuckwit played for laughs despite his actions being pretty much stuff that abusers do. We can tell Velvet has her head on her shoulders and is the most rational one. And she's voiced by Lily Cooper for some reason.
He tore up my best model, and you know the show can't wait for that unlucky bitch to pull herself back together.
Look, I like Lily, but her voice does not match Velvet's design and personality.
But the Vs point to a problem in the world building. It seems like the writers got too excited characterizing the overlords. So what did they do? They put the plot on pause for a second just so they could introduce them. And as I said, Valentino's the only member of the Vs to actually have some importance in season 1. Why couldn't the other two be revealed in season 2 and be like the main antagonist for that season? They could finally try and get their revenge on Alistair for whatever it was he did before fleeing for 7 years.
And that's another thing! This show is not subtle when it comes to the more hidden aspects of the lore!
In the first episode, Charlie drops the fact that her mom's been missing for 7 years. She says this to her girlfriend of 3 years, after she tells the story of how her parents met.
Once upon a time, there was a glowing city protected by golden gates. It was ruled by beings of pure light. Angels that worshipped good. Lucifer was one of these angels, but he was seen as a troublemaker by the elders of heaven. From the dust of earth, they created Adam and Lilith. Adam demanded control, and Lilith refused to submit to his will. Lucifer found her, and the two rebellious dreamers fell deeply in love. Together, they wished to share the magic of free will with humanity, but this gift came with a curse. For with this single act of disobedience, evil finally found its way into Earth. With it, a new realm of darkness and sin. Heaven cast Lucifer and his love into the dark pit he had created. Lucifer lost his will to dream, but Lilith thrived. Don't worry, Mom. I'll make you proud.
Charlie?
Oh, shit. Did you hear all that?
Yeah.
I'm fine. Just thinking, you know, family stuff.
Did you hear from your mom yet? Oof. How long has it been now?
Not that long. Only 7 years.
That's the first 3 minutes of the show. And I'll be honest, that isn't like the correct conversation Charlie and Vaggie should be having. Here's how I would have written it.
Hey, are you okay?
I will be, yeah. It's that time of year, you know?
I know. 7 years today, right?
Yeah. 7 years since I've seen Mom.
Yes, it's sure, but it doesn't pause the plot for some fucking lore.
Also, did you notice that Lilith and Alistair were missing for 7 years? Could those disappearances be connected? Of course they fucking are. 7 is such an arbitrary number to pick. It's so fucking obvious.
I did jokingly predict to Madeline it's a reference to the 7 deadly sins. But then again, I also said the 3 Bs were a reference to XXX. Like, you know how if you slash the 3 X's in half, it makes 3 Bs? If that latter theory is correct, I'm gonna fucking scream!
Alistair also has another piece of lore not elaborated on. What is it? He
allegedly
sold his soul to someone else and is doing said someone's bidding. How is this revealed? Did he hint at it via song? Are there subtle clues in the animation? Nope! The cat just flat out says it.
Big talk for someone who's also on a leash.
What did you say?
Subtlety is dead! Medrano killed it.
And the funny thing is, there is a subtle reference to it too. Alistair sings about it in the season's last song.
I'm hungry for freedom like never before. The constraints of my deal surely have a back door. Once I figure out how to unclip my wings, guess who will be pulling all the strings.
That's like the only reference to Alistair's indentured servitude we needed. That can be your fucking hint in the lore!
We're also learning too much lore in too little time. Like, by episode 8, we know the following. How hell was created. Why the angels carry out the exterminations. Whether the other angels knew about the exterminations. How the class system works among sinners in hell. Which overlord controls which kind of media or business or whatever. The names of most of the overlords. How you can kill an angel. How making a deal with an overlord works. And basically everything else I already mentioned.
And like, that's too much, man! Give the show a chance to breathe and explore what's already established.
I also take issue to the exterminations. One of the major plot points in this season is the demons learn exterminator angels can be killed by their own weapons. That's something no one knew about until this very show. In turn, that gives me several questions. You're telling me no one found out you could kill angels in all the exterminations existence? Like, come on, at least one person should have figured it out by now. Yes, Carmilla knew. She killed that angel and everything. And Vaggy asked her how no one else figured it out. This was her response.
Angelic steel isn't common.
So what? So what if angelic steel isn't common?
You had more than enough to help arm Charlie and her gang in time for the purge. You absolutely knew angels could be harmed by their own weapons, and you never told anyone? You never tried to reverse engineer the steel yourself? What the fuck? Hey, future Flower Gothic here. While editing this, it occurred to me that, at least in the show, it's heavily implied Carmilla did not know that angels could be killed by their own weapons until she had that incident in the show where she had to kill an angel to protect her daughters. But I just want to say that my point still stands. Someone should have definitely figured it out by now. Especially, you know, if angelic weapons are so powerful, she still should have been able to, or at least have tried to, reverse engineer them. Just wanted to make that quick clarification. All right, moving on.
But I will give Medrano this. Episode 6 has not just one, but 2 twists I didn't actually expect. And when I was doing my rewatches, there were subtle clues that pointed to them. And those twists were well thought out and put together. But for now, let's talk about the most problematic part of the show. It's edgy content.
One of the most common complaints about Has-Been Hotel is that it's unnecessarily crude. The characters swear like sailors, they drink like fish, they do drugs like there's no tomorrow, and they engage in illegal activities your mother would frown upon. And in my opinion, the complainers are correct.
But fans tend to forgive this for many reasons. For one, they're all gay. And second, they're all in hell. It's okay to be a terrible person if you're in hell, right? No!
You can't have, like, almost every character be a garbage person, then just hand wave it by saying, "Oh, they're in hell. It's okay." Why? Why does that make it okay? Besides, there are times we have to sympathize with these garbage characters. It especially doesn't work because people like them because they're terrible people, not in spite of them being terrible people. Contrast that with other crude adult show characters, like South Park. Yes, I'm going to reference South Park twice in one video, sue me. Fuck you. Cartman is a beloved character because he's a terrible person. He's racist, sexist, anti-Semitic, and that's the appeal. And there's never really an instance where we have to sympathize with him. He's just trash. Angel Dust is the most clear-cut example of this. He engages in many vices and crimes, including, but not limited to, drug and alcohol abuse, gun violence, making unwanted come-ons to male characters, taking Charlie et al. To a BDSM lounge without their consent, showing Charlie et al. Porn of him without their consent, basically just any sexual harassment you can think of.
And we're supposed to sympathize with Angel Dust for being in an abusive relationship with his boss, Valentino. That's despite the terrible shit he's done and it being played for laughs.
When their abuse is first showcased, both characters were beforehand played for laughs. That makes it more jarring and uncomfortable. By the way, this was in the same episode where Angel Dust showed porn of himself to the hotel denizens. And two episodes later, the snake gets sexually assaulted. That's played entirely for laughs.
You can't have it both ways, Medrano. Either play it for laughs or play it for drama.
Other adult shows have had to learn this lesson too. For example, sexual assault and rape is played for laughs in Family Guy, at least in its earlier history. Hell, Quagmire is basically a sex-addicted serial rapist. As a joke.
Hey there, sweetie. How old are you?
16.
18? You're first.
Mom!
Dear Diary, jackpot. Giggity.
Did you have sex with this underage girl?
I don't want to go to jail, but I really want to take credit.
But once, Family Guy tried to play domestic violence seriously. Enter From Stage Right, Season 10, Episode 3, Screams of Silence, the story of Brenda Q. The basic plot. Quagmire almost accidentally kills himself doing an autoerotic asphyxiation while watching clown porn. Yes, that's the joke. While in the hospital, his sister Brenda comes rushing in with her abusive boyfriend, Jeff. Jeff's abuse of Brenda is not played for laughs, unlike what you'd expect in a show with jokes like this.
We now return to Joni Loves Chris Brown.
Joni! Chris! Welcome to the party! Can I offer you some punch?
No thanks. I had some in the car.
The episode was heavily panned for that very reason. Family Guy's a cartoon long known for pushing the boundaries of acceptable humor. And here it's beating people over the head with a serious portrayal of relationship abuse. A portrayal that also, to an extent, victim blames Brenda and is a lesson in how not to help domestic abuse survivors. Episode 4 of Has-Been has a similar vibe. Yes. Valentino, as an abuser, is played much more realistically than Jeff. But it still involves characters played for laughs up to that point. And Angel's behavior after their confrontation is also played realistically. He tearfully tells Charlie to get out because he was demanded to by Valentino. This leads into a song number. And the shame is, this is the best song in the season by far. Poison is just tainted by the circumstances beforehand. It's still better than the other song in that episode, Loser Baby. In that song, the cat tells Angel Dust that their lives suck, everyone's lives suck, and all you can do about it is suck it up, Buttercup.
We're all living in the same shit sandwich. We're both losers, baby, we're losers. it's okay.
That's fine for like a gambling addict or an alcoholic, but Angel Dust is a sexual assault survivor. You can't just tell a sexual assault survivor to suck it up because life sucks. That's not how this works.
And yes, Angel Dust soon gets the confidence to stand up to Valentino and tell him off, but like, there isn't any buildup to that happening. Like, what made Angel Dust change? Because it sure as hell wasn't that song.
Okay, let's not talk about what I liked.
I just got home from work and I wore my dick stomping boots today, so give me a second, I gotta take these off. Let's get this out of the way. Earlier I mentioned there's a twist involving Vaggy that I really liked. Here is the payoff.
So in episode 6, Charlie and Vaggy go to heaven to make the case about redemption. Vaggy did so reluctantly, and I thought at first it was because, well, she's a sinner. But then we get the reveal.
Do you really think I wouldn't recognize one of my top girls just because you're at a uniform? I wouldn't forget a bad bitch like you. It's why I named you after the best thing ever, Vaggy.
That's right! Vaggy used to be an exorcist! And I didn't expect that. I truly thought Vaggy was a sinner demon who was new to hell, like in her previous backstory, the one in the pilot.
But when I looked at previous episodes, there were a lot of hints leading to Vaggy's true identity.
First off, Vaggy uses a spear commonly used by angels. Episode 3, Vaggy is put in charge of trust exercises at the hotel. Her idea of a trust exercise? Tossing the sinners into a turf war. According to her, the greatest bonds form in the field of battle. I originally thought that bit had more unfortunate implications. That was because of Vaggy's original heritage and the complicated geopolitical history of El Salvador. I thought it was referring to the country's gangs and the ongoing guerrilla contra las pandillas. Still feels problematic with the actual context, but that's just my opinion. And in general, Vaggy is a bad liar. I brushed that off too, thinking it was just her personality, but given she's an angel and lying is a sin, Viv, this is how you do foreshadowing. You drop little hints here and there that make total sense once the big secret is revealed. You can't just have one character say,
"Oh, Alistair, you follow orders from someone else too."
Because that's not how foreshadowing works. That's lame.
But this reveal also raises some questions. You know how I said someone should have figured out angels can get hurt by their own weapons before this show? Well, let's see how Vaggy ended up in hell.
Oh, run now.
Simple filth like you has no place in heaven.
Vaggy got hurt by angelic weapons. She lost an eye and her wings. How did she not figure that out? Like, how did no one figure that out? Like, even though Adam was there when Lute maimed Vaggy. That's the name of Adam's secondhand woman, by the way. I didn't talk about her much because she has little bearing to the plot. This was his response to seeing his own angels get maimed.
That's how they can kill us? With our own weapons? Fucking weak, dude.
So even he didn't know? How?
Episode 6 also had another twist that I liked. How heaven actually, well, works.
Throughout this video, you might have been wondering, what are the prerequisites to get into heaven? Does anyone know what it takes to reach those pearly gates? Here's the twist. Nobody knows. Not even the fucking angels know how to get into heaven. Which to me seems like, barring Adam, most if not all humans are predestined for hell. That's something I did not expect. Hey, it's Future Flower again. While editing this, I learned that Angel Dust canonically has a twin sister named Molly who might be in heaven. It's not quite clear. Like, in a stream, Medrano said that Molly is not in hell. She is not a demon like her brother.
Molly's not in hell. I don't know.
Molly's not in hell.
And there was an appearance of an angel in that episode that looked like Molly, but it has not been confirmed if that's her. So,
Yeah, this whole lore thing kind of contradicts itself, doesn't it, Jesus fucking Christ?
Considering what we heard about heaven throughout the show, I assumed it was one of those all drugs are bad, don't have sex before marriage kinds of places.
The only cool thing here is to say no to drugs. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm off to not have sexual intercourse before marriage. Yes!
Oh! But having it be a different shade of gray? That's legitimately interesting.
And also, I liked some of the musical numbers. They weren't perfect, but it's clear a lot of effort went into them. That's despite some of them not really having a reason to exist or be sung by one person or another. So what could Hasbin do to improve? First off, they need to hire more in-betweeners. Seriously, the animation gaps are fucking ridiculous.
Second, I would limit the cast of major characters to like 4 or 5. The show is clearly struggling to keep up with all the characters and trying to make us care about them, and I know who exactly they can cut. Nifty and the cat can easily be rolled into one character. Only one of the V's needed to exist in season one. Third, cut down the swearing, like a lot. As I said, I curse a bunch, but this is still way too much.
And here's something I haven't mentioned. In season one, there's no real overarching plot between these episodes. Well, aside from the purge. Like, every character arc is resolved within the same episode. There's no cliffhanger or any drama with these characters. There's nothing that doesn't get resolved with a little good old song and dance. It just feels weird. Like, the least interesting part of Hasbin Hotel is the Hasbin Hotel!
So here's what I do. I de-emphasize the overlords. I focus less on the lore of hell itself. Instead, I put my energy on the extermination and Charlie's efforts to stop it via the hotel. That's supposed to be like the main plot, right? You can't just plop all your lore down at once and expect us to give a shit about everything you've
come. And finally, I treat the serious subject matter with much more tact. No wishy-washiness, no laying us laugh at us say 1 minute then beating us up for it the next. We need consistency, Medrano. We really, really need consistency. I think Hasbin Hotel has potential. The concept in and of itself, demons trying to redeem themselves and go to heaven, is interesting. But Medrano and her team got too caught up in the lore and adult humor of the show. They got too caught up to truly explore that concept. And even then, some of the lore contradicts itself. It just contradicts what was previously said about the canon. I want the show to succeed. I genuinely hope season 2 has improvements. But for now, it will remain painfully mediocre. And all I can do is hope for the best in the future. Good night. And goodbye.